I'm going to discuss a seminar on science of Gita, or science in Gita, whatever. The idea is to show you that Gita is complete in itself, both spiritually and materially. Now we have all possible knowledge in Bhagavad Gita. All possible means not only spiritual, but all subjects in this material world, not in details, but in principles, are there in Bhagavad Gita. So that's what I'm going to show you today. And also I'm going to show you why Bhagavad Gita is so famous among all scholars, philosophers worldwide, and why it is applauded by so many intellectuals all around the world, in spite of it being called as a Hindu religious book. But it's not like that. Okay, let's see this. By the way, you can take this book and... This is the college which I am going to... I am planning to open. This is not a materialistic college, but a Vedic college, which we are going to open in Himachal Pradesh in India. There's a place where I'm intending to give seminars and courses on spirituality, science, philosophy, which can train devotees to preach to others and to themselves also. Both. Okay. This is the science of Bhagavad Gita. Yes. So... you know what, Bhagavad Gita is a very important tool, let's say, and a book to preach and to understand, because with this one book you can travel all around the world and challenge anybody. Not just spiritualist, not just philosophers, but scientists, theologians, theosophists, anybody you can meet, you can just challenge and you can just straight away quote from Bhagavad Gita. Like, for example, I go to America and I give seminars. I think two years back, I gave a seminar in Boston, America, Harvard University. And there were like scientists sitting. And I was speaking from Bhagavad Gita. But of course, I was speaking science from Bhagavad Gita. That's another thing. And they were impressed. And they say, yeah, they bought Bhagavad Gita. They bought it. If you know what I'm telling, it's difficult, very difficult to give this book to a scientist, especially in Boston and Harvard and MIT. If you're sitting, it's not a kid's job. But the point is, we have not to just read this book; we have to digest it. I'll probably just make a soup out of it and drink it. That's all we have to do. We should know in and out. There are many people in Vrindavan, I have seen, they can chant all verses of Bhagavad Gita from 1st to 18th chapter, from 1st to 700 verse, and then they can go backwards from 700 to 1st verse. That's how they know this book. That's what I was telling. You can afford to forget your name, but not this book. Don't forget this book. This is the book we have, which is a basis of Bhagavatam, which is a basis of Chaitanya Charitamrita. This is a foundation, by the way. Many devotees or many spiritualists, they somehow rate Bhagavad Gita not as important or below Bhagavatam. Like Prabhupada says, Bhagavad Gita is undergraduation, Bhagavatam is post-graduation, Chaitanya Charitamrita is super-specialization. But this doesn't mean Bhagavad Gita has less value, because without undergraduation, you can never understand what's super specialization. Undergraduation is, by the way, foundation, isn't it? If you look from other perspective. So what's there in this book? Why many people are praising this book? For example, many politicians, and like Mahatma Gandhi, and these quotations we have behind Bhagavad Gita. And Mahatma Gandhi said, "When doubts haunt me, when disappointments stare in me in face, I see only one rain of horizon, I turn to Bhagavad Gita." Now, I'm quoting a politician here because Mahatma Gandhi was a man of determination. He inspired, who was he? Uh, what's that? who was in Africa, who was like I think he was inspired by Mahatma Gandhi and Nelson Mandela. He inspired many people around the world, and his inspiration was Bhagavad Gita. So Bhagavad Gita can inspire politicians, by the way. That's the idea. It's not, you see, if you say Bhagavad Gita is just a religious book, what politician is doing with that? Mahatma Gandhi was a sort of religious and politician, but it inspired him. It inspired many writers. Aldous Huxley, if you know him. Bhagavad Gita is a more systematic statement of spiritual evolution. These are Westerners. These are not Indians. And they read Bhagavad Gita from a Western perspective, and they found it's a very systematic... You see the words used. It's a systematic statement of spiritual evolution and doing value to mankind. It is one of the most clear and comprehensive summaries of perennial philosophy ever revealed. Hence, the enduring value is subject not only to India but to all of humanity. This is Aldous Huxley. Aurobindo, do you know Aurobindo? He was a famous philosopher, even in West. A yogi, let's say. He was a yogi. He said the Bhagavad Gita, a true scripture of human race, a living creation rather than a book, with a new message for every age and a new meaning for every civilization. Beautiful. Even yogis, not writers, politicians, but yogis are praising Bhagavad Gita. Shankaracharya, even Mayavadi praises Bhagavad Gita. He's an Advaitvadi, he's ahead of that. He says, from a clear knowledge of Bhagavad Gita, the goals of human existence become fulfilled. Bhagavad Gita is a manifest quintessence of all the teachings of Vedic scriptures. Henry David Thoreau, this we have behind Bhagavad Gita. He was a philosopher, yeah. And this is, we have the quotation right behind Bhagavad Gita. This is William Van Humboldt, Prussian philosopher. He said, the most beautiful, perhaps the only true philosophical song existing in any known tongue, perhaps the deepest and loftiest thing the world has to show. Yeah, he's from Germany, by the way. Berlin, Prussian philosopher. And he said it's a philosophical song. Albert Schweitzer, he was a physician. Not just yogis, not just philosophers, not just politicians, but physicians. He came to India, he read Bhagavad Gita, and he said Bhagavad Gita has a profound influence of spirit of mankind by its devotion to God, which is manifested by action. He could also understand Bhagavad Gita as a book of action, not just meditation and, you know, all these things. He could understand that. Okay, the idea is why these people are praising Bhagavad Gita a lot. And I'm going to discuss in details now, but in one line, Bhagavad Gita is a conclusion of all Vedic knowledge. If you read Vedas, it's impossible to do that. First, to read Vedas, of course, you can download some translations from net, but that will make no sense to you, because all those people who translated Vedas, their whole agenda was very different. Like Max Muller, isn't it? And who else was there? Max Muller and who was there with him? Weber. And then William Monier, that dictionary, Sanskrit dictionary, all these people, they were commissioned by British East India Company to actually misinterpret Vedic knowledge and to show that Vedic knowledge has no purpose except doing some yajnas. You do swaha and that's it, and chant some mantras and finish. And they did like that. So you can't understand Vedas just by downloading translations. You have to learn Sanskrit, and for learning Sanskrit you have to spend 12 years. What do you do with that? And even after 12 years you learn some basic Sanskrit. For learning Vedic Sanskrit, which is different from normal Sanskrit, you have to spend another 12 years. And then you start reading Vedas. And then Rig Veda has some 1 crore mantras. What's in English 1 crore equal to? 1 crore? 1 million? Okay, 1 million mantras it has. Minimum. And then there's a third Veda, Samveda, Yajurveda. Then you go and read. And then also you will not be able to understand, because for understanding Vedas, you also need to learn 6 subjects more. Not just Sanskrit. That is Chanda, Nirukta, Jyotish, Shiksha, Kalp and Vyakrana. So Vyakrana you have learned more, 5 more subjects. What do you do with that? Then you have to spend another 12 years. You cannot read Vedas. It's impossible. Even if you try to do that. So what do you do with that? So that's why Krishna spoke Bhagavad Gita. He knew that If we don't read Vedas, there is no... Veda means knowledge. We don't have knowledge. So he spoke Bhagavad Gita. He summarized all Vedic knowledge in just 700 verses and 18 chapters. And made it very easy. If you read Sanskrit of Gita, it's any child can also understand, isn't it? Even without understanding Sanskrit, if you start reading, you can just make out something. So Krishna spoke in a very simple language for people like us to make sense of Gita. That is why Gita is the essence of all Vedic scriptures. It is said, Saram Saram Udhayartam. It's the essence of Vedas. Like, you churn something and then you again churn something and take it out. That's Bhagavad Gita. Not only philosophers, not only scientists, not only writers, politicians, even Vedas praise Bhagavad Gita. You can imagine. Vedas themselves, there is no Purana, there is no Veda which is not talking about Gita. So, like for example, Padma Puran, it has a full chapter dedicated to praise of Gita. Agni Puran, it praises Bhagavad Gita. Skanda Puran praises Bhagavad Gita. You take any Purana, it has to include praise of Bhagavad Gita. That's how important Bhagavad Gita is. Atharvaveda says, oh, this is a very beautiful verse, I purposefully put it, because yoga practices, Western word yoga, yoga, yoga. Okay. So then you can go to them and tell them, those fools who want to attain liberation by constant yoga practice without hearing the wisdom of Gita is fit to be laughed at even by a child. It's like that. You know, well, okay, fine, you do yoga, but then you have to add Gita knowledge. Otherwise, you don't understand anything. And Vedas themselves say, this will fit to be laughed at even by a child. Okay, Varaha Puran, verse 8, it praises Gita. Krishna is saying in Varaha Puran, Gita is my supreme knowledge. It is indeed my form, without a doubt. Even a half word of this Gita is eternal and beyond any material description. Even a half word of Gita. It is said in scriptures, if you know even one chapter of Bhagavad Gita, you get liberated. If you know even one verse of Gita, you get liberated. Even if you know half verse of Gita, you get liberated. And even forget that. Even if you know half word of Bhagavad Gita, just a word, you get liberated. Even forget that. Even you know, if you know the full stuff of Bhagavad Gita, you get liberated. That's said in scriptures. It's so important. That's why it should be on your tips. Bhagavad Gita, it should be on your tips. If in sleep we wake you up, 15 chapter, 14 verse, okay, you can say something. You know. Something, it should be like that. This is in one of, Skanda Puran says, Gita is the essence of all scriptures and thus special in itself. The idea is, I'm showing you intellectuals from the West, intellectuals from the East, all Vedas, Puranas, everybody praises Bhagavad Gita. Question is why? If it is just a religious book, why will so many people praise Bhagavad Gita? Why is that? What's the problem there? That we have to figure out. And that's what I'm going to show you. Why these people and Vedas are praising Bhagavad Gita again and again? What's so special in this book? We think it's a book of maybe Krishna consciousness just. No, that's not the point. It's not just limited to Krishna consciousness. It's a book for humanity. That's why these people are praising, isn't it? They don't really only find devotion there. They found many other things. That's what I'm going to show you today. Okay, Padma Puran, 17 chapter, 18 chapter, Agni Puran, chapter 381, Harivamsh Puran, and the list can go and go. Brahman Puran, Brahmavart Puran, Grahagarg Samhita, all Puranas, they have praise of Bhagavad Gita. I have read all of them, and I exactly know what how these books are actually giving Bhagavad Gita a lot of importance. Without praising Bhagavad Gita, no Purana is complete. Okay, in spite of so much praise, still people think Gita is a mythological book and it's a religious book. It's a common understanding. So before showing you why Gita is so important and so much praised and laudable, just briefly I want to tell that these people what think Gita is a mythological book, religious book, these both points are wrong. It's a bogus propaganda, or it's a bogus misnomer. It's a common misnomer. Gita is not a mythological book, and we know this. You know this Kurukshetra? This is Kurukshetra. This is the there's an immortal banyan tree. It's written there. Anybody gone to Kurukshetra? Visited? Okay, you saw that, the tree. It's immortal. Germans came there and they tried to analyze it, but they couldn't analyze the age. Age, maybe 5,000 something years, but they couldn't do anything. And it's immortal, it's considered. Because Krishna spoke Gita beneath this tree, it is said. He was standing beneath this tree with Arjuna on chariot. He spoke, this tree heard the Gita and it became immortal. That's the idea. Well, we are not becoming immortal. We heard Bhagavad Gita. What's happening? There's a problem with us. Okay, so this Mr. T.K.V. Rajan from Chennai, he's an archaeologist there in Kurukshetra. I met him and he found various artifacts in Kurukshetra there. They are the artifacts, arrows and spears, and they aged it and it came out 5,000 years ago. So we know that there was a battle 5,000 years ago in that place. It's confirmed archaeologically. And that's mentioned in scriptures. And scripture says, in the battlefield, Gita was spoken. So Gita is not a mythological book. It's a historical book, at least, if you want to take it like that. It was spoken. Now, it is not just a figment of imagination. And then you have Dwarka city. Krishna was there, we understand. Dr. S.R. Rao, he just passed away 2 years back. 3 years back, he was doing research in Dwarka. He found Dwarka beneath the sea. You see, there are walls of Dwarka there. He found walls of Dwarka. He found seals which were used by Krishna and Balram in his kingdom, and those were marked by Krishna Balram photo and a bull. And it's there, and you know, he found that. And it's Dwarka was there, so Krishna was there, and Mahabharata was there, and he spoke. This is what is he? So they found some stones which were used for ship, anchoring the ship. So we could understand in Dwarka, they were doing export and import. When Krishna was there, he was doing this. And we know this by Mahabharata. There were a lot of export and import with Greeks. And we understand by Mahabharata this was happening. And Krishna was doing that. Krishna and Balram, he was overseeing all those things. So the idea is, Gita is a historical book. And it was there. It was spoken. Is Gita a religious book? Well, Herman, he's a Swiss poet. He said, this is a beautiful quotation. Marvel of Bhagavad Gita is its truly revelation of life's wisdom, which enables philosophy to blossom into religion. This guy, he could understand Bhagavad Gita as it is, which even we can't get a hold of it as a devotee. He could really understand what's happening in Gita. The words he used, it's a life's wisdom, which enables philosophy to blossom into religion. And that's Bhagavad Gita all about. Bhagavad Gita is a book which marriages philosophy with religion. Which is, in modern world, philosophy is different. Religion is different, isn't it? That's what happened 100, 200 years back. All this, it happened in Germany and France. It's right next, you know. Nietzsche and all those people, Marx. They say, well, religion is different, philosophy is different. Forget that. First they separated philosophy from science, then they separated religion from philosophy, and was just separate. But he could understand philosophy and religion is intertwined. This I told you, Film Bumbold. It's a philosophical song, he said. And Gita itself defines religion. It's a beautiful definition of religion. You ask, what is religion? People think religion is faith. A blind faith. No, Gita says no. This is 8th chapter, 3rd verse. Svabhav adhyatma uchyate. Gita says, wherever, any religion which changes your nature, which helps you to change your nature from evil to good, which helps you to bring good qualities, that is true religion. Otherwise, it's bogus. Now that's a very good definition. It's a very universal definition. Gita gives universal definitions, not just designations. Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, this, don't forget it. If it is true, your nature and habits should change. If it's not changing in spite of following any religion, then either that religion is not right or you're not following properly. That's all. Simple. Svabhav means nature, adhyatma means religion or spirituality. Changing one's nature is spirituality or religion. Okay, so having said that, why so many people now praise Bhagavad Gita. Now we have understood it's not religion, it's not mythology, it's a reality. So I'll give you four reasons why so many people are praising Bhagavad Gita and so many lauds in laudable things in Vedas. The first reason is Bhagavad Gita is a law book. Now this term is important. You might have heard it, but it's important. Because there are two types of scriptures. One is decisive and one is informative. We can categorize scriptures into two. Some scriptures, they give us information. So if you read Puranas and this, they'll give you Mahabharata, Ramayana, it's all information. But Gita gives you decision. Now that's very important. Dharma Shastras will give you information. You have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this. But exactly, there's so many instructions what to do. There's so many philosophies, which philosophy should we follow? Gita is a decisive scripture. In the Sanskrit word is Nirnay Shastra. There's something called as Nirnay Shastra, Obdesh Shastra. So, you have so many Obdesh Shastra, but Gita will tell you which one to follow, which one not to follow. You see? Which one is right for this age? Which one is right for previous ages? You have to have decisions. So, if scriptures, you will also find contradictory proposals. Now, which to follow? What to do? Scriptures praise Brahmachari Ashram a lot. Sannyasis. They say scriptures. And on the other hand, scriptures also praise Grastha Ashram, householder. Both. So what to do? Should we become Grastha or should we become Brahmachari? Both are praised. What to do? There's so many injunctions like that. So always remember, Gita is giving you decisions. And that is why it's a very important book. Because without decisions, there is no point of information. Isn't it? You have so much information, but you don't have a decision power. What to do with that? You have so much data, but what to do with that? If you don't know, it's waste. It's useless. And that's why, you know, so nowadays, a new science is emerging in this internet age. And that's called as data analysis. You know that? Data analysts. Now, by internet age and Google, and they have collected so much data. But now they have to analyze what to do with that. So there's a new branch of engineering, data analysis. That's what Gita is doing. It's doing data analysis. If you want to understand any Vedas, any scriptures, first you have to read Gita. If you go to any traditional Gurukul, they will first teach you Gita. Without Gita, Gita is like eyes by which you can scan all scriptures. Otherwise, you'll become confused. 100%. So it's a Nirnay Shastra. Gita gives you decision. For example, Gita gives you a decision, who is God? Now, it might seem simple to you, but if you read Vedas, Vedas praise many deities as God. Vedas start with praise of Indra, and then Vayu, and then Agni, and they call them as God. And even Vishnu. So what to do? Who is God then? So people who read Vedas, then they think Hinduism is polytheism or even worse than that, anthropomorphism. There are so many words there. Henotheism, there are so many words there. There are so many gods. But no. Now Gita gives a decision. There is just one God. By all Vedas I am to be known. Sarvasyacham hridisan nivishto. Vedaisya sarve rahmavidyo. And you know how Gita gives his decision? Krishna explains in Gita that yes, all Vedas praise other demigods as gods. Yes, okay, fine. We understand that. But then Vedas say that actually they are not praising demigods. They are praising Krishna by the names of demigods. You see, that's the solution there. Sarva namadha eva. That's the verse used in Rig Veda. You see, in Vedas, there is a praise of Shiva. Now you might think when you read, okay, oh, this is Shiva, see. And they're calling Shiva as God. Okay, Shiva is God. As if they're praising Indra. Okay, yeah, Indra is God. It's there, Indra Sukta. But then Veda says, no. They're using the name Indra to praise Krishna. You got my point? Indra means king. So they're calling Krishna king. Shiva means all auspicious. They are using the name of Shiva to praise Krishna, and Krishna likes this. Krishna likes this indirect glorification. That's very nice. And that's very common. Like, suppose if you go to India parents will name their children as what? Sometimes they name their children Ram. You know this in India? Or maybe sometimes Krishna. So similarly, when Krishna made this creation, there were many demigods. And they asked, what's my name? So Krishna says, well, I have many names. I'll give you my names to you. You see the point? And to Shiva he said, okay, one of my name is Shiva, I'll give you this name Shiva. One of my name is Ganesh. Ganesh means he's a lord of all people. I'll give you this name Ganesh. One of my name is Indra, and I give this name to you. So actually, Vedas are not praising any demigod. They are praising God with his original names. But then we get confused and we think they are praising demigods. You see the point? How Gita is explaining? Gita is a decisive scripture. It's giving decision. And this is a beautiful verse here. It also decision. It's giving decision. What is the best yoga? There are so many yogas. Jnana yoga, karma yoga. So many yogas. But then Krishna says in 6th chapter last verse, Bhakti yoga is a supreme form of yoga. By reading Vedas, you will not be able to understand. The initial part of Veda is talking about karma yoga. The middle part is talking about jnana yoga. The last part is talking about bhakti yoga. If you read Vedas like that. Samhitas are talking about karma yoga. Upanishads about jnana yoga. Then Puranas are talking about bhakti yoga. So which yoga to follow? Krishna says, okay, this is the best yoga. Bhakti yoga. The second reason, not only Gita is law book, but Gita is a book with less letters and more meaning. That is the beauty of Gita. Concise and precise. Every verse of Gita can have 1,000 meanings. You know this? Minimum. Every verse. Of course, Prabhupada has given one meaning, which is a devotional perspective. But every verse of Gita can have 1,000 meanings. This is said by Madhvacharya. All of thousands we can't access. It's not open to humanity. But at least 8 meanings we can access. But out of that, I'm just telling you 3 meanings. There is something called adibhautik meaning, godly meaning, spiritual meaning and scientific meaning. Every verse. Every verse can be translated from a devotional perspective of God, from a spiritual perspective of soul, and from a scientific perspective of matter. God, soul and matter. Same verse can have 3 meanings. Minimum. 8 meanings we know. Rest 1,000 meanings we don't know. How to get out of it. Now, Madhva knows. We don't know. But that's the beauty of Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is a compressed knowledge. Or you can say, you know, in computer language, zip folder? It's like zipped, you know. You should have a program to unzip it. That's one thing. And that is should be here. Okay, so I'll give you an example for that. So everybody knows this verse? Na sato vidyate bhavo, na vidyate sato bhava. Oh, sorry. Na sato vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate sata. This Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, 16th verse. The spiritual meaning Prabhupada gives. This is from Prabhupada, spiritual meaning. For the non-existent, the material body, there is no permanence. And for the eternal, the soul, there is no change. That's clear? It's clear to all of you, isn't it? Yes or no? Come on, I have to know whether you're understanding or not. The spiritual meaning, okay. This verse is talking about soul and body. Body is temporary. It doesn't exist forever. Soul is permanent. It's always exist. This is a scientific meaning. And I'll ask you something. Now you hear properly. Now, what exists will always be there. What does not exist will never be there. This is a scientific meaning which comes from Sanskrit. If you know Sanskrit, you can derive. So, na asato. Asato means temporary. Bhavo means existence. Asato means what doesn't exist. What doesn't exist cannot exist. And sato means exist. What exists can never not exist. You understand? No. In simple words, if you really understand Sanskrit, this means what exists, it exists. What doesn't exist, it doesn't exist. And so what's this? Which is this law? Of science. You know this? There's a law. Yeah. What's that? Which one is that?
Conservation of energy.
Conservation of energy. Energy can neither be created, neither be destroyed. It's there. What exists, it always exists. It's neither created, neither destroyed. What doesn't exist, it cannot exist. Simple. It's a law of conservation of energy. This was pointed by Madhvacharya in his books 800 years back. Newton said 300 years back. Law of conservation of energy. This is said by Madhvacharya 800 years back from Bhagavad Gita. We knew that. Law of conservation of energy. And so there is a scientific meaning and spiritual meaning, and then there is a devotional meaning to this. And that is very important. Every verse of Bhagavad Gita is talking about Krishna and Radha. Every verse. Every verse of Bhagavad Gita is talking about Rasila of Krishna. Every verse. But if you know how to decode it. Now I'll show you how it's happening in this verse. A little Sanskrit knowledge you should need. But anyway. Na sato vidyate bhavo. Asat. Sat means permanent. Asat means temporary. Asat also means if you cannot achieve a goal, you're called asat, isn't it? If you cannot achieve goal, you are called asat. If you can achieve goal, you are called sat. So this verse, so asat are those gopis which could not go to Rasleela of Krishna when Krishna called them. When Krishna played the flute, so many gopis went in the night. Some gopis couldn't make it. So those gopis are called by asat here. Nasato vidyate bhavo. It is said, those gopis who could not go to Krishna, they didn't exist. That means they died. And they left their body, and in spiritual body they joined the Rasleela. They left their body. Na bhava sate sata vidyate. Sata means who could go to Krishna. All these Radha and all these eternal gopis, they went to Krishna. Who went to Krishna, na abhavo. They did not stay in the house. They cut all material relationships and they could make it to Krishna. So this verse is talking about liberated gopis and gopis which just joined Krishna's pastime, sadhana siddh gopis. That's all. It is explanation by Vallabhacharya, by the way. It's not my speculation. I didn't speculate sitting. I can't do that. Vallabhacharya explains that. So you see, every verse, 7 chapter, first verse, Maya Sakta Mana Partha, Yogam Yunjan Madashraya, Asamshayam Samagra Mam Yatha Vyasa Sita Shinu. That's the 7 chapter, first verse. That verse is talking about flute of Krishna. Now you can't see it because it's not there. So that's the idea there. Bhagavad Gita is, that's why people praise Bhagavad Gita. Even Sanskrit scholars praise. Even though it's Sanskrit is so simple, if you go to any Sanskrit scholar, he will say, yeah, this is a book you have to understand. If you want to learn Sanskrit, Gita and Bhagavatam. They are very tough because it has multi-layered interpretations. Multi-layered interpretations. And that's what we have to read Gita from that perspective. That's why these people knew who praised Bhagavad Gita. They knew what's happening there in this book. Okay, this is one example how it has at least minimum 3 meanings. There are 8 meanings. So there is something called yagyik meaning also. Meaning from the perspective of sacrifice. And then there is meaning from the perspective of history. Puranic meaning. So there are minimum 8 meanings which Vedas mention to every verse of Bhagavad Gita. And every word of Bhagavad Gita is a name of Krishna. That's also like that. Even that word na, you know na? Na. So what that means? Not. Simply not. But that's the name of Krishna. So every word in Gita is name of, Vidyate is name of Krishna, Asat is name of Krishna. Bhava is definitely a name of Krishna. Bhava word comes in Vishnu Sahasranam, we know that. Sata is a name of Krishna, even Na is a name of Krishna. Every word of Gita is name of Krishna. That's why when you chant Gita, every verse, even if you don't understand, you're actually glorifying God. By His names. There's so many names, Mahaprabhu says. Nam, Namakari, Bahuda, have millions of names. But, of course, you don't understand how that is. But if you study systematically Bhagavad Gita, you can understand every word is a name. In fact, every gap, there's a gap between Na and Asat. You see that? There's a gap? there is also knowledge there. Yeah, if you know how to take it out. That is our scriptures. That is our scriptures. There's a knowledge which you can't see when you can take it out. By the system of Vedic knowledge, by the system of Nyaya and Shiksha. If you know that system, you can take that out from there. Okay. The third reason why Bhagavad Gita is so special is because it's not only a law book, it's not only concise and precise, it gives us complete knowledge. Krishna says, Bhagavad Gita 7.2, I shall now declare you in full this knowledge, both material and spiritual. This being known, nothing further shall remain for you to know. Jnanam aham sabhijnanam. Material and spiritual. Krishna says, I am also giving you material knowledge. So where is that? Where is chemistry? Where is physics? Where is maths? Where is psychology? Where is biology in Bhagavad Gita? What's happening? Is Krishna speaking a lie? No. Of course, he can't speak a lie. So it is there. I'm going to show you how it is there. I'm giving you some examples now. And this is what I talk to scientists when I go. If at all I have to talk about Bhagavad Gita. If you're talking about consciousness, something else, you're talking something else. And you're talking about quantum and chaos and emergence theory, functionalism, you're talking. But if you're talking about Gita, you talk like this. So how it is complete knowledge? Bhagavad Gita has philosophy. You see, by the way, before this, knowledge in this world is divided into three sections, three broad sections. One is formal sciences. Formal sciences are hardcore science. That is physics, chemistry, maths, and also biology. Isn't it? These four subjects. They are hardcore sciences, formal sciences. Then we have something called as, this is at one end. Other end is philosophy, which separated from science. Philosophy deals not with hardcore sciences. Hardcore sciences deals with observation, hypothesis, experimentation and theory. And the language of hardcore science is mathematics. You have to prove everything mathematically. Now, at the other end is philosophy. That's also knowledge. But philosophy helps to analyze. Philosophy is a knowledge which helps you analyze knowledge. You see? So that's called epistemology and ontology, morphology. Philosophy is different. It's dealing with more with those subjects which science cannot deal, which are not quantitative subjects, like aesthetics, beauty, ethics, morals, which science cannot handle. Science doesn't have tools to handle those subjects. Beauty, love, what do you do with them? That's with philosophy. Or metaphysics, like soul and God, it's all for philosophy. There are two ends. In between, there is another branch of knowledge which is called as normative sciences. That means psychology, social sciences, isn't it? These are not exactly hardcore sciences because psychology is dealing with emotions and feelings. You can analyze, but at the same time, you can't give a clear-cut quantitative picture. So you're all understanding? You're on the same page? You're getting this point? So there are broadly three subjects like hardcore science, psychology and philosophy. Gita touches on all of these three dimensions of knowledge. So Gita is touching on philosophy, you see. I'll show you the example. Philosophy. This is philosophy in one line. 6th chapter, 21st verse. Yam lavdva na cha param labham manyate na adhikam tata. This is the goal of all philosophy. Krishna says, upon gaining which there is no greater gain. This is what is philosophy for. We are trying to find something. Upon attaining that, you don't want to attain anything else. You are completely satisfied, isn't it? If philosophy doesn't give you satisfaction, it's useless. It's nonsense. It's not philosophy. That should be the purpose of real philosophy, isn't it? Satisfaction. Krishna puts it in a very beautiful words. Upon gaining which there's nothing greater to be achieved, greater gain to be achieved. So, Bhagavad Gita defines the goal of philosophy. Bhagavad Gita also defines philosophy as such. There were three revolutions in philosophy, if you know that. The first revolution was brought by René Descartes. You know this person, Descartes, yeah. Yeah, Descartes. Yeah. So he brought a revolution. The next revolution was by Ludwig Wittgenstein. And the third revolution was Thomas Kuhn. So what they said is, and all these revolutions are mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is all about decision, I told you. Bhagavad Gita has these three uniqueness: decision, definition and distinction. No other scripture will give you these three topics. Bhagavad Gita gives you decision. It gives you definitions of every word. It is defining what is God. It is defining what is love. It is defining what is liberation. Vedas don't do that. Vedas uses the word, but don't define. And Bhagavad Gita gives distinction. It gives a proper perception to perceive the Vedic scriptures. Otherwise you can't understand that. With what consciousness we have to approach Vedic scriptures. Now, René Descartes, basically, in this modern philosophy, he was talking about decision, that's all. René Descartes said, okay, there is matter and there is, it's a dualist theory, you know this, no? Dualism. There is matter and mind. Let's separate them. Now, he said, okay, as scientists, we are concerned with matter. Mind, give it to church. That's all. It is there, we'll let them handle. So he divided. He gave a decision. René Descartes brought a revolution of decision. A decisive point in science. Which separated science and religion and philosophy forever. And Gita is all about that. Ludwig Wittgenstein was a linguist. He brought a revolution in philosophy by saying that language is all that matters. Language. If you change the language, philosophy changes. And that's what is all Gita. Gita is talking also about language. What I'm trying to impress you is, these concepts of revolution, they are coming from Bhagavad Gita. You see? The concept of language, which can define philosophy. That's here in Bhagavad Gita. The concept of dividing matter and mind, that concept is coming from Bhagavad Gita. Thomas Kuhn talked about change in paradigm. Paradigm shift. So he says science goes in paradigm shifts. First there was Newton, he talked about classical mechanics. Then there came Einstein, he talked about relativity, which was just contradicting classical mechanics. Then came quantum physics, which is contradicting relativity. You know, nobody knows how to relate all the three. Nobody understands now. This concept of multi-level layers of reality. Everything is real. Classical mechanics works. Relativity works. Classical mechanics works in this world. Relativity works in sky, macrocosm, universe. Quantum mechanics works in microcosm, in atoms. At least that's what we understand. But how to relate them? How do you understand that? So, that means there is multi-level layers of reality, not just ideas. Reality is also existing multi-level layers. This concept is coming from Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita talks about multi-level layered reality. It talks about that. And that's, so the point is, all concepts in philosophy and science, all paradigm shift, these concepts are there in Bhagavad Gita already. That's why Krishna says, I have given you complete knowledge. Complete knowledge. And we know in history, many scientists, they were aware of Upanishads, they were aware of Gita. Isn't it? Einstein had a big library. And even Newton, he had access to Eastern knowledge. We know that. And they were reading. Even today, so I visited MIT. I asked a physicist there. And he said, even as physicists, we still read Upanishads. Because we know there is knowledge of reality, not God. They're not interested in God. They understand that. And that is Bhagavad Gita all about. That's what I was impressing you all about. Bhagavad Gita also talks about wrong philosophies. Philosophy is all about what is right, what is wrong, isn't it? If you want to be a philosopher, you have to prove all other philosophies wrong. Isn't it? Otherwise you're not a philosopher, you're not called as a famous philosopher. So Bhagavad Gita talks about right philosophy, and this is all wrong philosophies in one verse. Gita is so nice. Krishna summarizes 16 chapter 8 verse, all wrong philosophies of this word in just one verse. Just one verse. You don't need to read so many books to understand. Krishna gives a decision. This is wrong. These philosophies are wrong. Asatyam apratishtham te. The first philosophy, asatyam. This is the philosophy of Buddhism, by the way. Buddhism says everything is illusion, isn't it? Buddhism says everything is ephemeral. Even you are illusion. Basically, only thoughts are real, isn't it? So they have a hard time to explain reincarnation. Buddhism, everything is zero. Nothing exists. What is reality? Nothing. And that's the idea. So Krishna says, no, that's wrong, according to Vedic opinion. Okay, apratishtante, jagad aur anishwaram. The philosophy which says anishwaram, anishwaram means there is no God. The philosophy which says no God, that's wrong. Forget it. So modern Western atheistic theories which say no God, that's wrong. Aparaspara sambhutam, philosophy which says that the realm of spiritual and the realm of material, they are two separate realms. They are not linked. That metaphysics, this is physics, there is no link, that's wrong. Krishna, by the way, probably believed in, Plato probably believed in Gita philosophy. Plato said, you know, that there is a Platonic word which has an influence on this reality, isn't it? They were all into this. There's a link between higher realm and lower realm. But all these philosophy, including science, they separated it. That's different, this is different. Krishna says, that's wrong. And kim anyat kama haitukam, kam haitukam, philosophy which says there is no cause in life other than lust, simply enjoy. That philosophy is wrong. That's materialism, isn't it? There's no other purpose to life, simply enjoy. You don't have to worry about anything. Just do it. Whatever you want, just do it. Krishna says that philosophy is wrong. So he encapsulates all philosophies and gives his decision. You see, it's a very beautiful verse. And then there are more philosophies talking about. I'm not going to Sanskrit, but Nyaya, Visheshika, Sankhya is talking about all those things. Krishna, Gita is talking about psychology. Now I told about philosophy, psychology and hardcore sciences. Gita is also talking about psychology. Now this is a very... You see this verse? This is a famous verse. 18 chapter 35th verse. This is talking about tamogun. Tamogun, mode of ignorance. Krishna says, and that determination which cannot go beyond dreaming, fearfulness, lamentation, moroseness and illusion, such unintelligent determination, O son of Partha, is in mode of darkness. Krishna in this verse is talking about determination or intelligence. Intelligence, function of intelligence is determination. Krishna is saying that intelligence which is full of dreaming, fear, lamentation, illusion, that intelligence I consider in mode of darkness. Simple. But actually, this verse, if you decode it, there is full psychology in this verse. Any concept in psychology is coming from this verse. Now, I'll show you how. This is Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is using these words. That is modern psychology. Dreaming. What Krishna called as dreaming, modern psychologists call as delusion, hallucination, schizophrenia, and psychosis. Isn't it? That's a dreaming state. What Krishna calls as fearfulness, that modern psychologist called as paranoia. Paranoia is a condition where patients fear. What Krishna calls as lamentation, that Krishna modern psychologist calls as depression. What Krishna calls as moroseness, that is modern psychologist called as bipolar disorder. What Krishna calls as illusion, that modern psychologist called as mania and insanity. So all diseases of psychology, they are in one verse of Bhagavad Gita. And all diseases arise from mode of ignorance. You see, that they don't know. That they don't understand. Krishna gives more depth. Krishna says any mental problem, any psychological problem, these are the most common psychological problems. They are arising from mode of ignorance. That's all. If you can just change the lifestyle of the person from mode of ignorance to mode of goodness, which 18 chapter talks about, you can treat any psychological problem. Modern day psychology is all about medicines, isn't it? Psychology has reduced to psychiatry. Medicines. They don't understand. They have no concept of mode of ignorance. And Gita gives the insight into psychology. Gita also gives insight into biology. Now this is hardcore science, formal science, which I was talking about. Gita doesn't support artificial life, which scientists are trying in laboratory. Let's create life. Krishna says, Aham Bija Pratapita. Krishna says, I am the life-giving source. You cannot make life in laboratory as scientists are trying hard, you know, artificial life and then silicon-based life, something, you know, all these things. You can't do that. It's just a waste of time. Many scientists says, it's a waste of money and time. You can't do that. It's impossible. You can't create life in lab. Bhagavad Gita says that. Bhagavad Gita says evolution is wrong. Frankly, in this verse. It says, 13.5, Brahma Sutra Padaishava Hetu Madhvir Vinishita. Krishna says, everything in this world has cause and effect. Everything. Evolution believes there is no cause. Isn't it? And there is no effect. That's basically evolution theory. Do you understand? That's evolution, no? Everything is by chance. There is no cause which these things are happening. It is by chance. That's all. And what's the purpose? No purpose. Krishna directly contradicts. Krishna says, no, these theories are wrong. Everything has a cause and an effect and a purpose. And that's Gita talking about biology. No evolution. Evolution theory doesn't accept. This is about psychology, philosophy and biology. You see how Gita is talking about complete knowledge. Gita is fourth reason why Gita is so praised. Not only it's a law book, not only it's precise, not only it's complete knowledge, it is also an instructional manual. Instructional manual for your life, for mind, for intelligence, for matter, for everything, for society. And I'll show you how it is. Gita is an instructional manual for matter. Now, I just quoted this, cause and effect. Science means, science basically, if you put aside evolution, science basically means cause and effect. That's what we're trying to find, isn't it? We observe a phenomena, what's the cause of this? Isn't it? That's what we ask. Then we do experiments and this, and then we use it or we exploit it to get a technology. What's the effect of it? That's Gita is a manual for matter. Matter behaves like this, cause and effect. Cause, you put a ball, it goes there, hits something, that's a cause, and then the effect, force. So matter behaves like that. Gita is talking about matter. Instructional manual for mind. This, you know, this verse, everybody knows, 6th chapter. One must deliver himself with the help of mind and not degrade himself. Mind is a friend of conditioned soul as well as his enemy as well. This is a beautiful instruction for mind. Is there any such kind of instruction in modern society? No. Modern science is even debating whether mind exists or not. That's such a stupid level they have reduced to. Everybody has mind. Everybody is conscious. That's the only reality with us, isn't it? Consciousness? There's no other reality. Everything can be illusion. Everything can be a matrix in one sense. Everything can be virtual reality. But your consciousness cannot be. The fact you are conscious, that cannot be illusion. But they are discussing whether consciousness exists or not, whether mind exists or not. That's a discussion going on. It's a very stupid discussion which is happening in science. And many scientists admit it. It's not just me. David Chalmers, Thomas Nagel, big philosopher scientists, they say, what's happening, you know, what's happening in science? They are determined to not accept consciousness and mind in their theories. They start with a premise that these things don't exist. And that's where Thomas Nagel, he said in his book, the problem is not that you don't have evidence of God or soul or afterlife. The problem is we cannot accept such propositions because of our scientific worldview. Thomas Nagel, philosopher. And actually he's a big philosopher. If he says it means something. If you know that. So he says this. Everybody understands something is happening in science. So that is manual for mind. You can degrade yourself. You can uplift yourself. It's a matter how you train your mind. Bhagavad Gita is a book which will train your mind. There is no book in this world which will train your mind. There's no book. No college. That's why Prabhupada went and challenged all universities. Okay, where is the department to train mind? and all these professors, what? No answer. No answer, in fact. Okay, Bhagavad Gita. Okay, this is very nice. It's an instructional manual for mind. You see this verse, this one verse, 18 and 14, 18 chapter, 14th verse. It is summarizing all the psychological theories which you have in one verse. Now, we have mind. A mind is influenced by many things, isn't it? A mind. Krishna says your mind is influenced by five things. So the first is place of action. Isn't it? Place of action, which you are acting. The performer, you yourself. You will affect your mind, your own ideas. Your senses, eyes and nose, how much agitated they are, what's happening in your senses, it will affect your mind. Isn't it? If your hand is paining, it will affect your mind. If your eyes are paining, it will affect your mind. And your endeavors, your goals, your set ideas, that will affect your mind. Thought process, isn't it? Okay, I want that. It will make your thought process go in a different way. And your subconscious mind. Now, Gita introduces the concept of subconscious mind. It was not Sigmund Freud who gave this concept of subconscious mind. We understand he is the father of psychology, isn't it? You know this, no? Id, super id. Do you know this? You've read this? Yeah, id. You call us id here? Conscious, subconscious mind, superconscious mind. It was not Freud. Krishna uses these words. Krishna, in Gita, it's their subconscious mind. And your subconscious mind affects your conscious mind. These five factors affect your mind. What else do you need? If you can manipulate these five factors, you can control your mind. If you know how to manipulate them. And that knowledge is given in Gita, 18th chapter. Krishna is talking about all these five factors. And he's saying you can manipulate each of them. You can bring each factor in mode of goodness. This is what mode of goodness is. And then you can control your mind. So beautiful. And modern psychology is based on these five factors, isn't it? Place of action influences mind. Modern psychology, the branch of modern psychology, social psychology and cognitive psychology, deals with this aspect, how place of action influences mind. Social psychology, isn't it? How society affects your mind. That's this concept. The performer, you yourself affect your mind. That is the field developmental psychology. Your various senses affect your mind. That's a field of reflexology. Many different kind of ideas affect your mind. That is called behaviorism. The branch of psychology, behaviorism, it analyzes how your endeavors affect your mind. And your subconscious phenomena affects your mind. That is by Sigmund Freud. You see, the idea what I am trying to tell is, the various branches of psychology which now they have come up, it's already there in Gita. Krishna already analyzed everything. How your mind is affected. And now then they did research and this and then come on, it's there. All science is there in Bhagavad Gita. Okay, this is about mind. Gita is also instructional manual for intelligence. Now, Gita raises very important questions. What is source of knowledge? This is epistemology. Who am I? This is basically ontology. What is the purpose of creation? This is teleology. What is the meaning of life? This is morphology, ontology. Why there is suffering? This is this again. You can put in epistemology. How to become eternally happy? This is eschatology. These are various branches of philosophy. It's all there. Krishna is dealing with every branch of philosophy with one question, and all answers are there. What else do you need? This book is complete. Nobody can challenge this. If anybody challenges, you can show them. See, this is complete book. And shut up then. That's all. Okay, this is instructional manual for body. Krishna doesn't give you just principles of soul. Krishna also gives you principle of body. How to become healthy. Now this verse is very important. Bhagavata 6 chapter 17th verse. You might have heard this. But Krishna says, Yukta har viharasya, yukta cheshtasya karmasa, yukta sapna bodhasya, yoga bhakti dukha. Krishna says, he is balanced in habits of eating, sleeping, recreation and work, can mitigate all material planes by the practice of yoga system. This is a basis of Ayurveda. Any Ayurveda book, Charak and Shushrut and Vagbhat, it begins with the principle, if you control three things in your life, you will always be healthy. Eating, sleeping and exercise. Krishna talks about that. Eating, sleeping and recreation and work, that is exercise. This is called three pillars of health. Traya Upastamba in Ayurveda. Three pillars of health. If you know how to sleep, principles of sleeping, principles of eating and principles of exercise, you will never become diseased. And the relationship between them. how sleeping affects eating, how eating affects exercise. So independently, what are the principles and what is the link? If you can understand, then you can always be healthy. This principle is in Bhagavad Gita, and details you can find in Ayurveda. It's there. So Gita is, you see, I was telling, Gita is defining things. Gita is giving basic principles. Might not be so much details, but principles. Then if you read 18th chapter, Krishna is talking about three types of food, isn't it? Food in mode of ignorance, goodness, what to eat, what not to eat, how to speak, austerities of speech, what to speak, what to think, how to act. What do you need? What else do you need? Like, you can throw all books in ocean. There'll be no loss to this word. It was said by Bhakti Santa. You drown all libraries of this word in an ocean, there'll be no loss. But if this book is lost, this word has no basis of true knowledge. And you know how this book will be lost? So not because printing press will close, or we will have no e-books. No. This book will be lost if there is no person who understands this. That's how books get lost. We have knowledge, we have books, but we don't have a person who understands that. What do you do with that? All kind of Vedas are lying in library in Delhi. You go there. But they are just rotting around. Now somebody can say, you have knowledge, but you don't have knowledge, you don't understand. Dhanurved is there. There's a small book of Dhanurved. Dhanurved means military science. Yeah, it's there. We don't understand. I read it. We can't do anything with it. We can't decode it. Nobody knows what to do. So it's lost. So the idea is, we can preserve this knowledge not just by printing books, not just by only by distributing books. We can preserve this knowledge by understanding it. And every person who understands that, he is an asset to this world. Any person who doesn't understand this book, he is a burden on this earth. That's all. That's what scripture says. So if you have to save this knowledge, you have to understand it like this, properly. At least study Bhagavad Gita. Prabhupada says 100 times. Prabhupada said that to one of his disciples. 100 times. Minimum 100 times. Minimum. And then you should just remember Bhagavad Gita like in sleep. If I ask you, you should be able to tell like this. And then all these details of Bhagavad Gita, you have to somehow get it in your blood. Somehow. By hook or crook, Prabhupada says. If you read it again and again, we understand it. Okay, this is manual for body. Gita is instructional manual for society. You have to run the body. You have to keep your body healthy. You have to keep your soul healthy. You have to keep the society healthy. Then the world is happy. So Krishna gives instructional manual for society. To run any society, you need three things. Achar, Vyavahar and Prayaschit. To run any society, any civilized man should understand how to do personal conduct, isn't it? How to behave, how to talk. Otherwise, it's not civilization. They are barbarians. Any civilized society must know what are the social norms. Personal conduct means how to eat, how to sleep. Your conduct. Social conduct means how to behave with others. And then civil laws should be there, isn't it? Any society, there have to be laws and constitution. And then any society, there should be laws which punish if those constitution is broken. And Gita talks about all three. Achar, Vyavahar and Prayaschit. Personal conduct, social norms, civil laws and punishment. 16th chapter, 1st to 8th verse talks about Achar, personal conduct. You know this? Divine qualities. 1st to 8th chapter. That's personal conduct. Those qualities, if you have, your conduct is good. Simplicity, generosity, compassion, wisdom. You know, that's personal conduct. Social conduct, Krishna is talking in 17th chapter and 18th chapter. 7 to 24, 19 to 39. In which Krishna is talking, what is austerity of speech? What is intelligence? What is determination in three modes of nature? What is austerity of... How to conduct your body? How to respect others? You have read that, no? All these things. 17th chapter and 18th chapter. What is sacrifice? What is charity? What is austerity? What do you mean by helping others? What do you mean by welfare? Those are the three modes. He defines all aspects of social conduct in 18th chapter and 17th chapter. And then punishment. 17, chapter 25 to 27th verse, he talks about what kind of punishment you can give if somebody breaks these norms. Basic principles he's talking about, not just details that you have to keep in mind. And then Gita is instructional manual for soul. This is 7th chapter, first verse. Maya sakta mana partha. Krishna says, you see how I'm practicing yoga in full conscience of me, with mind attached to me. You can know me in full, free from doubt. This is manual for soul. The only greatest and the only unique quality of soul is attachment. Isn't it? Soul wants to become attached to God. It is searching for God. And Krishna defines yoga in this verse. Krishna says yoga means to become attached to Him. Yoga is directly linked with soul. Soul and Supreme Soul, the link between that. Krishna defines that. Krishna defines, gives an instructional manual for soul. Simple. And then, finally, Krishna gives instructional manual for life. How do you run your life? What do you want in your life? You want money? You want success? You want career? No. Krishna says, your life is complete when you have these three things. The first to sixth chapter talks about karma yoga. In other words, values in life. If you translate it into very practical sense, karma yoga is giving you values in life. Values, you understand? Moral values. It will bring moral values. This is what your values, your vision should be fixed on. Bhakti yoga, which is 7 to 12, that's talking about happiness in practical terms. Bhakti is to do with happiness, isn't it? The bliss of spirituality, how to get happiness. And the last 13 to 18 chapter, Jnana Yoga, that's talking about knowledge. Everybody wants knowledge. Knowledge satisfies us. So Gita is giving you material and spiritual knowledge both. So that's what life is. Knowledge, values and happiness, isn't it? That's what everybody wants. They want to become knowledgeable. They want to have moral values. They want to become good. And they want happiness. That's what actually we all want. Although in the race to attain this, we forget that we began the race to attain this and we are involved in just running, you know. That's the idea. Then we forget everything. We are just trapped in that race. In the thrill of that race, let's say like that. In that thrill, we get lost. So Krishna says, this is manual for life. Knowledge, value and happiness, which I am giving. And that's what is Gita all about. That's why Krishna praises his Gita by his own words. 9th chapter, 2nd verse. Raj vidya raj guhyam pavitram hetat uttamam pratekshvagavam dharmayam susukham kartam avyayam. Very nice verse. Krishna says, this knowledge of Bhagavad Gita is the king of all education. The most secret of secret. It is the purest knowledge because it gives direct perception of self by realization. It is a perfection of religion. It is everlasting and it is joyfully performed. He praises Bhagavad Gita by his own words. You can imagine how much important Bhagavad Gita should be if God himself praises it. It's not philosophers, it's not scientists, it's not writers, it's not politicians, it's not Vedas, it's not Puranas, as I showed. It is God himself. How much important it should be. And that's why please read Bhagavad Gita. 100 times minimum. Hare Krishna, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Any questions, any comments? Yeah.
How is Sanamwan connected to Krishna's fruit?
Oh, okay. Yeah, I can explain you, but it needs a little knowledge of Sanskrit. Maya sakta mana partha yoga myunjan manashraya. The idea is, mai means me. Mai means me. Asakta mana partha. Now, if you know Sanskrit, asakta means attachment. That we understand that. So what is most dear to Krishna? What is the most, which object is most intimately united with Krishna? Flute. Even gopis say that. Gopi says, we cannot attain the nectar of your lips, which this flute is getting. Flute is always with Krishna. It's the most intimately united. So, mai asakta, flute. Manah partha. So, Krishna says to Arjuna, he brings the concept of mind. Krishna says, in the flute, I don't play the flute. When I play the flute, And this, the voice of flute, the beautiful song of this flute, when it falls in the ears of demigods and gopis, their minds are agitated. Mai asakta mana. You see the point? How flute is linked to mind? Flute agitates the mind of devotees. Mai asakta mana partha yogam yunjan madashraya. This is real yoga, Krishna says. This union between my devotee, like flute, and me, that is real union. That is yoga. Yogam. And because of that, all devotees become united with me. When he plays the flute, everybody's mind is fixed on him. Yogam yunjan madashray. Yunjan means the process of uniting. So demigods are busy somewhere in management, something. Krishna plays flute, everything is stopped. We know that, no? Everything stops. Yunjan, that's the idea there. Mad ashraya. And this flute is such a nice devotee that it inspires others to take shelter of Krishna. That's the first line. We can get in second line also, but that's it like that. You see the idea. This is commentaries given by acharyas like that.
The other question I have, since you're a great scholar, maybe if you know the significance of when Krishna plays flute, that it says in many verses that he plays the fifth note.
Yeah, yeah.
What is that?
Fifth note is, you see, like that. Sa re ga ma pa, it is pa. Now, pa is very important in song. Now, if you read poetry, poetry has three parts: rasa, dhwani, tal, lay, and rag. Like these components, music has these components. Now, in all components, this pa is very important because this pa, our starting point is sa, sa. But demigods start with pa, their starting point is p. So they go in very higher octaves. We just mostly work in middle octave. They go in higher octave and then they go even beyond that. This koel cuckoo, it has pa here, fifth note. Mozart, fifth note, you know. Fifth symphony, he's fifth note. So that's very sweet. That is why Krishna says flute, that fifth note is important.
I just heard about some musicologists that explain the sound of om, which is like quint note, which is actually first and fifth combined.
Yeah,
I was wondering if that has some significance.
Yeah, some people say like that. Some music, it analyzes om like that. We have a science behind this. And that is mentioned in Lakshmi Tantra. There is a Tantra, Lakshmi Tantra. It mentions, it's very complex. So they might understand that. But there is a concept like this. I am aware of that. But explanation, it's difficult. I don't know. Om, yeah, something like this. Yeah.
You were speaking about 216. This, if I'm not mistaken, our acharya translates this verse of the non-existence. There is no appearance and of eternal.
Yeah, yeah. That's what I
translated it a bit differently.
No. Spiritual meaning was that. Scientific meaning was different. That interpretation.
How you can deduce the law of conservation?
Acharyas do.
From this,
because through Sanskrit. Sanskrit, if you know Sanskrit, you can deduce from Sanskrit. So every word has a different meaning. For example, the word go.
Yes.
Sanskrit word go, it has 32 meanings. Well, we just know cow, and then what sense is? Go also means clouds. It means rain. It means earth. And there are 32 meanings. What do you do with that? Hari. You know Hari? Hari has 18 meanings. One is Krishna, one is monkey. Hari means monkey also. And there are many meanings. So that's why Sanskrit is a very rich language. You can deduce anything from anything.
But it says, this translation says, of the non-existence, there is no endurance. Which means, it exists for a while, but it has no endurance, no real value.
No. Non-existence never exist. That's how we translate that. I'll tell you afterwards. I'll show you. No problem. It is pretty simple. Okay, anything else? Or we'll stop here. So how many of you will read 100 times Bhagavad Gita by next year? You have to make a target. Otherwise you'll never live in life. You'll never read in your life. Never. You have to keep that book with you. That's all. I read Bhagavad Gita some thousands of times. I've read that. And the technique is keep that book with you. Just like you keep phone, take a small pocket, keep it in pocket. Whenever you get time, open it and read it. So then you start remembering it and you start reading it. That's how you do, otherwise you don't get time. And the more you read, the more you understand. That's how Krishna Swami says, the more you rub sandalwood, the more it smells. The more you read, the more it reveals itself to you. That's how we understand these books. There's not one time reading, two time reading and it's boring. It doesn't happen like that. And if you don't have this book in your mind, you can't advance. It's impossible. Your mind will be spaced out. It will be spaced out. Your body can be busy, but your mind will be really going out somewhere. It's Krishna's words. We can't afford to forget it. That's the idea. Yeah, you wanted to ask Jagannath Sutta Prabhu something? Okay. So, thank you very much for attending this seminar. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.